Welcome to the first in the series of the Foden's Lockdown podcast, supported by Arts Council England and brought to you from the lavish surroundings of my kitchen table. I'm John Barber, and in today's show, we're joined by Director of Lions Youth Band Nigel Birch, star patron and genealogist Irene Garner, the principal cornet of Foden's Youth Band and rising star that is Nadia James, and lastly, our mystery Foden's band member. I'll be dropping some clues as to their identity throughout the show. I won't lie, there are no prizes for guessing who it is. However, you might want to reward yourself by enjoying a socially distanced high five with your nearest and dearest. In addition to our guests, we'll be enjoying some music, catching up with how Foden's band have been staying connected in these difficult times, and of course playing the instantly engrossing game, Who's the Mystery Foden's Band Member? And on that point, here's your first clue. Our mystery player was once offered a commission in the army. Well, with that information, for those of you who know the band well, you can probably lay flat some of those faces in this particular version of Foden's Guess Who. I'm delighted that we're now able to meet our first Foden's Lockdown podcast guest. Each episode, we're going to take the opportunity to talk to and find out a little bit more about not just Foden's band, but also the broader community that we as Foden's are part of. And part of that social web is our work with and support of the brilliant youth bands we're lucky to have here in Cheshire East. I say lucky, but as with all these things, in truth, there's no luck about it at all. It's down to the dedication, hard work and commitment of a team of people who provide such an incredible platform and opportunity for young people to take part in. Right here in the middle of Sandbatch, we have one of those organisations, a group that members of Foden's band have had the pleasure of working with regularly, the fantastic Lions Youth Band. So I'm delighted that right now we're able to welcome along their conductor for a chat. So hello, Nigel Birch. Hi, how are you?
I'm very well, John. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. How's lockdown treating you?
Not too bad. It started off really, really weird, but you know, you just have to try and adapt, don't you? And work with what we've got till we're able to sort of move forward.
And have you found that you've had additional time to do some of those other hobbies that you might not normally have had time to cram in?
It's really strange, really, because all the things that obviously I like, playing Crown Green Bowls, I'm very highly competitive bowls player, well, we can't play. Well, we can't play now competitive games. We can go up to the green, have a practice, but that's not quite the same as playing competitive sport. And also, the obviously, the football's been cancelled up until now. So that's, you know, another thing.
Are you still training, though?
I'm still training. And as I don't drink anymore, obviously, the visits to the pub are not as frequent as what they used to be. So times have changed quite considerably.
Oh, blimey. Well, thank heavens for this chat. Otherwise, you'd frankly have nothing to do. So you're the director of Lions Youth Band. And yeah. I know we just had a chat about something else. But to me, I've been in and around Sandbatch for sort of 20 odd years. But it just seems like you've been there forever. When did it start?
So I've conducted the band for 26 years out of its 30-year history in two spells. I started in 1990 and... When I went, I was invited to go along to the band by the conductor at the time, who was Andre Helluer, who was a former solo horn player with Foden's. And he said, I'm thinking of leaving the band. Would you be interested in coming and taking the band? And I'd had a little bit of experience, but not a great deal. And I said, yeah, I would be very interested. It seemed like a good setup. And so I did.
It's amazing. What an amazing tenure that you've had. I mean, I teach at Sandbatch School, and I sometimes have to dip in on a Tuesday before a Foden's rehearsal. And let's not kid ourselves. It is swamped with young brass players. Mm. I mean, so the organisation has three bands. Is that right?
Three groups. We have a beginner section. We have a junior, sort of, which is like an intermediate level. And then we have the youth band. So, yeah, we have three sections. Each are able to perform in their own right. So even at beginner level, they perform as a band. And now we've got Jamie Sharp, of course, as you know very well, who's leading the group and taking the band in quite a different sort of direction than it's been before.
This is the junior band, right?
The beginner band. And the children are finding that really sort of inspirational, the different ideas that he brings. So that he's been a great addition to our team in the last 12 months.
You've managed to maintain that standard over the years, you know, which is amazing. Is it just that they have to understand the ethos, or is there anything more? Is there anything else you've been doing to maintain so consistently those high standards over the years?
Yeah, I mean, I made a conscious decision about 10 or 11 years ago, and I was talking to our very good friend Mike Fowles the other evening, and made a conscious decision that I was going to change the slight way of working. Over the years, we'd invited quite a number of high-profile professional conductors to come in and out of the band. Howard Snell had come to the band, Richard Evans, you know, all really, really good people, and sort of other people from time to time. But I wanted to create a consistency of idea and professionalism. And that was when we first... So 2009 was the first time that Mike Fowles came to the band. And he's been coming ever since. And we then started to do the regular workshops with Foden's. And this consistency of message, of the way to do things and the professionalism, is one that's really, really worked for us. And I was talking with Mike. Since that 2009 period, we've played at the national contest 10 times. And we've got an average of third place.
Amazing.
That really shows that the investment in what we do is really, really working.
No, it's a fantastic achievement, you know. And I know we've talked about you know our phones, you know, especially now we've got so many of the bands living in the same village that that they still try and fly the flag for the area. I think, you know, Lions have absolutely done that for so many years as well, and of course none more so than the last year, following you know the fantastic second place in 2018 at the national finals. To get to go to Montreux for the European, you know, we were all there on that Sunday morning watching it on TV. I mean, what an amazing opportunity for the young people in the band.
Yeah, I mean, I remember standing behind the stage before the band were due to play. They'd walked on, and I was with Steve Barwick and I was with Jane Stubbs, and they said to me, "You don't look worried. You don't look nervous." I said, "This is what you dream about, isn't it? This, you know, moments like this when you start conducting, when you take the players in, when you're preparing the players week by week, these are the moments that you dream about. And I haven't come here to feel worried. I've come here to enjoy it."
Amazing.
You know, and it was great that the actual performance was right at the end of the weekend, so we could have some social time together. The band could go around Montreux. You know, they visited the Freddie Mercury statue, the museum, and just all of that. And then the plane came right at the end, and that was the, you know, sort of the icing on the cake at then.
How have you sort of sought to motivate the young people at this time when they're not meeting every Tuesday? Has it been difficult? What have you been doing?
So I saw it very much as an opportunity for me to really get to my players and say, look, we're not going to let this overtake us. So the production of lots of videos, you know, we did the Over the Rainbow video first, and it received 12,000 views, you know.
Amazing.
But we'd have never done it if it wasn't for lockdown. You know, so out of what is a bad situation, actually, we've created a wider audience for the band. You know, and as we've moved forward, you know, all of the videos that we've done have created that for us. And then we did each year, each player has to do an assessment. So we didn't cancel those. Every player submitted their assessments for me to listen to, and I was able to give them their feedback as I normally would do. So that's all still gone ahead. We've had sort of presentations. Mark Wilkinson's done a presentation for us, David Thornton, various, you know, high-profile professionals just to really, again, say to players, even though you're in lockdown, don't forget about doing your practice. Don't forget about doing your basics, you know, because when you get back to normality, you'll still need those skills, you know, to get you through the initial period, certainly. So, you know, we have worked very, very hard. And, you know, we'll continue to do so.
What's the first project or the first thing you're going to do? Any ideas?
Yeah, I mean, I've got three goals. I've set three goals for when I get back to band. To create a more entertaining, a more vibrant, a more open forum for the band to play in. Okay. And the second one is to be pioneers of a more diverse culture within the band. That's obviously quite high profile at the moment. And so I would like to see Lions as an organisation reach out to the community and say, we've never ever turned a person away, but there are people out there that may feel that, you know, that's not something that they can belong to, where that is totally not the case, you know. So we're going to reach out into the community and hopefully make us more diverse about the people that come into our band.
Wonderful.
And then the third thing is to protect the long-term nature of the band. So recruitment is very difficult at this time, and people aren't taking up instruments in the same way. You know, in September, when there would be a normal starting of people playing instruments, it's not going to be the same, you know, for some time. So it's really important that when we get back, that we really sort of work hard. And it's at the lower end of our organisation where we need to invest.
Sure.
Because it's not very often we get players of a sort of grade 6, grade 7 standard knock on our door and say, we'd like to join the youth band. It's not really the way that our organisation has ever worked. It's usually from the bottom upwards.
Grassroots, yeah.
And then they feed through. But without that, you know, it sort of stagnates. So, you know, there is going to be a lot of investment in time and as much resources as we can into getting young people sort of a primary school age into the organisation.
Well, what I would say, Nigel, is that you've overseen the Lions band and obviously been such a huge part of the structure for the best part of 25, 30 years, and you know, you've not put too many feet wrong yet. So I'm sure you're doing the, you know, what you will do will be warmly received and will undoubtedly be for the right reasons to support the band going forward. Nigel, I've taken up so much of your time. Thank you ever so much for being part of this first podcast.
Yeah, great.
Yes, well, we'll see what everyone says, whether it's great or not. But certainly, we're grateful for your input. So thanks ever so much. 30 years not out. Keep it going. Mm-hmm. And hopefully, when all this this madness is behind us, we can collide for our normal Monday morning cup of tea in the office.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much indeed. And hopefully, see you very soon.
Thank you, John. Thank
Cheers,
you.
Cheers, Nigel.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
On Tuesday the 30th of June, Lions Youth Band held their annual awards ceremony. It was moved online this year and included a number of socially distanced performances. It's our pleasure to share one of these with you now. So here is Lions Youth Band and their socially distanced recording of the Beatles classic, Yesterday. Thank you. Formed 33 years ago, Foden's Patron Society is made up of some 400 members who support the band not just financially, but also through helping to run events, selling tickets, marketing, running bars, and generally being amazing. It's the band's absolute pleasure to get to know them better each year when we bring them together for their own Patrons concert. So we're now delighted to be joined by Irene Garner. We're hoping to be joined by one of our amazing members of our Patron Society on every show. And Irene's a long-standing supporter of Foden's band. She's often found supporting our concerts, taking tickets at door, handling our cash, mopping up any of the spilt drinks that have been done, mopping our brows, generally speaking, making sure that everything is ship-shape so that we're able to go and do the easy stuff of playing our instruments. Irene, how are you? Thank you ever so much for joining us.
I'm fine, thank you, John. It's lovely to talk to you. Obviously, I'm in isolation like so many of us. I've really not been any further than the few yards from the front door to clap on Thursdays. That's my social life for you.
Oh, gosh, blimey. And we had a brief chat earlier. In terms of the shopping and getting food in, you've managed to get some support to help you there?
Absolutely wonderful. A young man across the way calls for my shopping for me. He doesn't mind what he does. He'll go to Handy Household or the local shops. He's been wonderful. So thank you to Michael for that. And another friend, Tim, did the supermarket, the heavy stuff. So I'm very, very lucky that I've been well looked after.
I have to say, community is one thing that has really resonated through this whole lockdown, hasn't it? You know, and reflections on both sides. One, I think the fact that so many people have done these generous acts and supported us and helped us, but also possibly for many of us, me included, a realization that actually we can so easily feel sort of isolated from our normal community. And at that point, you know, we found that technology has in some degrees helps to step in and help us to reconnect or to keep those connections alive. And I know that in your daily life, you're in your field of work, using technology has been something that's allowed you to continue doing that. In fact, you've been doing it probably before lockdown. Can you tell us a bit about what it is that you normally do?
Yes, I work as a genealogist. So I give talks, I take classes. I'm very lucky in my classes because I've got guys that set up all the technical equipment for me. I walk in and just literally do the spouting. But I've had to learn to do all that for myself. I wanted to keep in touch with my classes. So first of all, we started using WhatsApp. I found some of my members hadn't got a clue what WhatsApp was, so we were really back to basics. Then we moved on to Zoom. I won't say we're proficient at it, but it's held us together, and it has been nice to be able to actually give a class via Zoom. This last talk, which I gave yesterday, one of my colleagues, Anne, dear old friend, she's pretty good on presentations on laptop, which I don't do in my classes. One of my guys does it for me. She was taking emails off me with links through to actual parish registers. We were going back to 1666 yesterday.
Wow.
And she was doing all that with slides on the computer as I gave the commentary with her help. So we've had to learn the hard way with technology.
Are you saying that not everybody in the class is as yet proficient with it? What have been the challenges that some of them have faced? Is it just the mechanics of using it, or?
Yeah, just getting into Zoom's been a main challenge for some, and then actually getting to link in with the computer yesterday was a nightmare. I think Anne and I were nervous wrecks by the time we got to the end of that one. By the time we got everybody and we could see everybody on screen, and I was actually seeing what we'd present, you know, we were presenting, it was one enormous sigh of relief, believe you me.
This is what you do, and you are somewhat of an expert in this field. And I know that in some of the notes we were talking about, that you used to be sort of on a retainer, so to speak, on hold by the BBC to give, you know, to share information. Can you say anything about that, or give an example of when you needed to do it? Or
yes, I'm basically an in-house expert. That's how I'm my blurb comes over from other people. I'm associated with the County Record Office at Stafford, whom I'm fortunate enough to work alongside. So I absolutely love that aspect of my job. The BBC, I used to broadcast from the studio, but also I was on tap at home, and sometimes I'd get a call 15 minutes beforehand saying, "We're talking about so-and-so, can you be on standby?" And I'd be there in the middle of mopping the floor, so I'd have to move the bucket out of the way to go and broadcast to 180,000 people.
Good grief.
It does teach you to think on your feet. Or on your knees if you're mopping the kitchen floor, of course.
We're in a strange lockdown situation, and one of your specialist fields is the Derbyshire village of Eam. Have I said that right, Eam?
You have indeed, yes.
Wonders will never cease.
Well done, John.
Thank you very much.
You can give out pencils.
That's about the limit of my skills, I think. And you were saying that this village in Derbyshire, they had some kind of virus, but they were locked down in 1665, is that right?
That's correct.
Why were they? What was that to do with?
It was the plague, Great Plague, which of course swept through everywhere. Nantwich got it, for instance. It was all over the place. Great Plague is particularly remembered in London, but unbeknown to medical science, the minister there, Mompesson, actually decreed that there would be no public meetings. They would cut themselves off completely from all the other villages. No one was allowed in or out. And even food would be left on the borderline and then collected by them. So they had lockdown, and theirs lasted for 15 months.
As you say, I mean, the parallels with what we've been experiencing globally, it's quite apparent, isn't it? It's really amazing.
It is amazing.
And so in terms of your connection with the band, how did you first become aware of them?
I didn't come from a banding background. We got to know Foden through being here for the transport festivals. And then it spread from that to a couple who's still associated with Sandbach asked us if we could possibly help out. They were in a bit of a tight spot for a concert, and would Jeff and I help out? So we both got a musical background. My parents were opera buffs, and I was a chorister from about 5 years onwards, and still am. And we went along and thoroughly enjoyed it. We were glad to help, but we thoroughly enjoyed it. And I think that must have been 12 or 14 years ago. So from helping then, just for one night, I'm still running around after you all with my clipboard and the raffle tickets.
You mentioned there about being a chorister. And one of the things that you mentioned in the past is that you were right. Back in 2012, we had this this wonderful opportunity to perform at Manchester Cathedral. And you were part of our performance that night.
I was indeed. I was very proud to be in the chorus then, as you say. Jeff and I sang in three choirs at that time, so it was a great honour. But the double thrill was, not only was I singing there, we walked past the trophies, because it was not only the Hillsborough Memorial, you'd also won the doubles championship that year. So we marched past those two trophies on our way onto the stage to sing for his Requiem with you. It was a wonderful, wonderful concert and a wonderful evening. And unbeknown to the band, you don't know this, but I do, our conductor, Mike Fowles, mouthed every word of the Latin Mass for us as he conducted us.
It was definitely the Latin. He wasn't just trying to go through all these shopping lists for on the way home. It was definitely the...
I wondered why two baked beans came in. Yes, it's quite a thought. I never worked that one out.
We get it in rehearsals as well. It's not a surprise to me. So I just want to finish with one question for you. I know these things happen sort of very, very quickly. I can't believe we've been talking for so long already. But we've asked a few people that we've spoken to questions out of the blue. And my question would be this. Someone who spends their time looking back and seeing about the positive things and maybe the mistakes and all the rest of it that people in society have either made or tried to avoid, if you had one piece of advice that you might want to maybe offer for our next generation, what might that be?
Oh, well, my favourite composer is Bach. Absolutely love Bach. And one of his quotes is, "I was obliged to be industrious. Whoever is equally industrious will succeed equally well." Oh, Barky baby, if only we could.
Yes, very, very true. Very poignant. And perfect, perfect. I think it sums up all of our kind of inner ambitions and just get off our backsides and get on with it, really. Irene, thank you ever so much for spending some time with us and sharing your memories of the band, but also a bit about your life. It's been a great pleasure to talk to you. Best of luck with the rest of lockdown, and hopefully we shall see the other side of it very, very soon.
I shall be there. The minute we're let loose, I shall be back with my friends of Foden. Thank you so much, John. It's been a pleasure.
All right, take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.
So back to our edge of the seat drama that is Guess the Mystery Foden's Band Person and our second clue. Following on from the theme of the Lions Youth Band recording, our mystery band member was born the year that Paul McCartney announced he was leaving the Beatles. Spoiler alert, it's not our 18-year-old first horn player Grace Jeffers. Our mystery band member was born in the year that Paul McCartney announced he was leaving the Beatles. Time now for some music, and we turn to the pen of Peter Graham. Commissioned by the YBS band, Windows of the World is a kaleidoscopic six-movement sequel to Cry of the Celts. Here then are Foden's band performing the finale, Earthwalk. We'll be right back. Foden's band has for many years been heavily involved in supporting the development of young brass players, both locally and nationally, visiting a number of bands annually, told coaching days, masterclasses and training sessions. In 2012, Foden set up their highly successful Foden's Youth Band. Formed and spearheaded by Foden's cornet player and committee member Ian Raisbeck, the group draws some 60 young brass players together each month from across the UK to take part in full band rehearsals and sectionals with Foden's band members. So it gives me great pleasure now to welcome the principal cornet of the Foden's Youth Band, Nadia James. Hello, Nadia. How are you?
Hi, I'm good, thank you. You?
I'm very well, thank you. Thank you ever so much for joining us. We're in the middle of a lockdown, which is a bit strange. How's it been? You're someone who's studying your A-levels. You're in receipt of some homeschooling. Just talk me through it. How's it been? Is it very different? Are you coping? Do you like the homeschooling? Do you hate it? What's going on?
It's been very interesting. So basically, I'm mostly being sent work that I can easily do from home. But then the hard bit is kind of trying to get it all back in, scanning everything, and then, you know, nothing works. You can't read anything. You know, you've got teachers going like, I can't open this file you've sent me. But then the other hard thing is there are so many distractions at home. I never thought this would be a problem because, you know, at school you've got other people that could distract you, but the motivation's a real issue, actually.
So what are the distractions at home? What are they? What's the main one other than, is it your brother?
Mostly just like the temptation to go off and just do something else, something fun, instead of just, you know, getting on with it. So
Your teachers will be shocked to hear that you're not necessarily referring to all that coursework as something fun. I'm sure.
Oops, yeah, hopefully they won't listen to this.
I'm sure. Well, maybe they will. Now, obviously, one of the subjects you're studying is A-level music. And obviously, a big part of that is performance and obviously playing your cornet. So within this lockdown, I know that me personally, I really benefit when the band, the Foden's, play twice a week because they're doing concerts. It's reason to keep motivated, to keep playing, and I'm kind of able to keep top of it. I personally found it really hard to kind of just get motivated about getting it out of the box every day and doing the stuff. How have you found the motivation for playing your cornet?
Definitely also very hard because there's nothing to really work for. In the sense that you used to have like concerts and stuff and, you know, actual pieces that you had to practice for. You know, playing whatever you want is actually not as easy as it sounds because you just feel so lost. I don't know.
That makes sense. I think so when there are challenges to work through, be it something technical in a piece or a band part, or, you know, and obviously you lead two bands, you know, in your seat on principal cornet, that something you've got to nail, then obviously there's a desire to make sure that you're not just doing it for yourself, but making sure that for everybody else who's kind of relying on you to get it right, that there's a need for you to practice to make sure that happens, right?
Yeah, definitely. And I think another thing I'm missing about band is the stamina, because you have these 2-hour rehearsals and you're just kind of playing all night, and without them, even no matter how hard you practice, it's just not really the same. So I've been really struggling with stamina recently, actually.
When did you start playing your cornet?
So when I was 7, so I think I was in year 3 at primary school, and there was an event at school where this music kind of organization, they brought in different instruments for everyone to try, and the only instrument I could get a note out on was actually the cornet, so they just stuck me on that, and I started having lessons in school.
So it's purely by luck.
I'd be in a very different place right now.
Obviously I know that you're playing in Foden's Youth Band. Do you, or have you played in other groups locally in, you know, since you managed to get that first note out of your cornet all those years ago?
Yeah, so I started off in Winterley. So there's the Winterley Methodist Band, and then there's also a training band. So I went up through the training band and then went up to the main band. And then I also played for co-op junior and then youth wind bands.
Oh, great.
So that was really good. It was... You know, so you had your brass band and then your wind instrument. So it's a really good mix of the two.
And then, as we've alluded to, in addition to Winterley and the co-op, you also then took a seat with Foden's Youth Band. When did you join the band?
I think I was 11 when I joined. So I think it was in second year.
Right.
and because my teacher had suggested it to me. At first it was really not hard, but it was certainly very different, because even though it was a youth band, everyone was so much older than me, so I struggled to kind of fit in. My first few rehearsals, I was like a bit scared of going because there are all these amazing players there, and I just felt so like small. Do you know what I mean? So what? It was, but yeah, then as I got through the band, I made like new friends there, and it was just a really amazing experience.
So you've done a whole enormous journey. You've sort of gone in from a young 11-year-old who's been, you know, a little bit terrified of their surroundings to working all the way through the ranks to sit on that principal cornet chair. That's a tremendous achievement. It really is.
Oh, thank you. I'm really glad I joined, because it's just been amazing.
Are there any aspects of the band or anything about the band in particular you really enjoy?
I think it's just a really friendly, you know, atmosphere there. And we are all kind of a similar age. I mean, when I was 11, everyone seemed, you know, just basically adults, but obviously we're not. So that's just really nice, you know, to have all these people your age with a shared interest. And also we've got Mike Fowles and Mark Bowser, you know, they're just really great conductors. And obviously all the tutors are amazing as well. So you really do learn a lot.
In addition, obviously, to Foden's Youth Band, you are the principal cornet of the Marple Band. Now, yes. This is, and you know, for those people who don't know, the Marple Band is a band with an enormous rich history, you know, previously championship section band, winners of the British Open. And obviously at the time it was another female principal cornet player, Helen Fox, mm-hmm. as it was at the time, Helen Williams now, who was principal cornet. So you're sitting in a seat that's held some real history. How did the appointment come about?
Well, I was looking to kind of get some experience on a principal seat, and we saw that they were advertising, so I decided to go down and try out for them.
What was the process like?
It was actually quite a nice process, because they sat me on end chair, but they said, you know, if you don't want to play anything, just hand it down. So it was all very kind of informal. It was really relaxed. Well, I played all the solos on there, in the pieces they were doing. And they just asked me if I wanted to come back. So, it felt really good knowing that, you know, if I wasn't really comfortable doing anything, they would be all right with that and they'd step in. So, just a really good environment to come, and I just felt really welcome there.
So just moving away from music for a second, obviously you're very busy with schoolwork, you're very busy with when we're not in lockdown, with your music. Do you have other things that you do outside of school and music, other hobbies, other interests?
Well, recently I've been doing a bit of baking and cooking. I've always liked baking. Yeah, I think cooking's definitely a bit scary for me. I tend to try and follow the recipe, I'm too cautious, and then I'd freak out if things start going like a tiny bit wrong. So I'm trying to get out of that stage so that when I do leave home, I can kind of cook things without, you know, getting in too much of a panic.
Are you a bit of a perfectionist then? Is that what, you know, you like to think you're just absolutely right?
I mean, I guess so. I like baking because it's all very precise, whereas with cooking, I keep getting told, you know, stop trying to be so exact. You know, you don't have to do, it doesn't matter if you haven't got enough of this ingredient or that. But yeah, I do get a bit stressed if I don't know exactly what I'm doing.
Talking of looking forward to your perfect future bakes, you're currently in year 12. Yeah. Next year obviously is A levels. What are you hoping to, which direction, where next after college?
I'd really love to go to music college. I just think it would be so fun to kind of focus on performance the whole time and kind of get all the experience with playing in different types of ensembles and all the different performance opportunities. I think my first choice would probably be the Royal Northern, because, you know, it's so central. It's got all the bands around it. I mean, I don't know what it is with the Northwest, but we have got a lot of bands here, haven't we? So I think
we do.
That would be really, it would be really cool to just have that kind of community.
What we're going to do is we're going to play Would You Rather. I'm not sure if you've ever played this before. So they're basically questions that have got two answers, and all you have to do is choose which answer you feel sums up your thoughts best. That's it. Okay, we're off. Would you rather read a great book or watch a good movie?
Oh, I'm so indecisive. I'm going to be terrible at this. I think read a good book.
Okay, very, very good. Would you rather go into the past to meet your ancestors or go into the future to meet your great-great-grandchildren?
Meet my ancestors.
Oh, very good. Would you rather have more time or more money?
Ooh, more time.
Okay, so this is, you should be loving life right now, just to be really clear, loving life right now. Would you rather have a rewind button or a pause button on your life?
Rewind.
Would you rather win the lottery or live twice as long?
Oh, win the lottery. I know that goes against what I said about time, but...
They're just purposely here to make you contradict yourself. So would you rather be the most popular person at school or the smartest?
Most popular, sorry.
Wow. Okay, cash and popularity. This is one. Would you rather put a stop to the war? Would you rather put stop to war or end world hunger? Sorry, that got really heavy there for a sudden. We were talking about really lightweight stuff, and then that came up. I don't know who put that in there. You still have to answer.
I'm just going to say put a stop to the war.
Would you rather hear the good news or the bad news first?
Bad news first.
Well, in that case, the bad news is the time's run out. Thank you so much for joining us. It's been an absolute pleasure to get to know you a bit better, to hear about the great things that you're up to. Wonderful that you're surviving and not going completely out of your head, despite whatever those distractions are at home. Best of luck for your future, and thanks once again for joining us. Our final musical offering for today is Foden's performance of Kachaturian's Lizhinka from his ballet Gaiani. The final Guess the Mystery Foden's Band Person clue is that our band member likes nothing more than pulling on some lycra and getting outdoors to exercise. As an avid triathlete, they can be found sweating whilst running up a hill, sweating whilst on a bike, and even trying to hide the sweat whilst swimming in open water. If you haven't got it already, July's Mystery Foden's Band member is Robin Basu. Good morning, how are you?
Fantastic, John. Good to be with you.
Thank you very, very much for joining us. So how have you been finding things during the pandemic? Have things been very, very different?
Yeah, well, I think no more different than it has been for anybody else. But generally, yeah, I've got to say it's been pretty good. I can't complain. I've been working throughout, so I think I've been more fortunate than many other people out there. So it's been good. It's just adjusting, isn't it, to having, say, your family around you all the time, not seeing friends and colleagues that you're used to seeing on a regular basis. So, but no, I can't complain. I think I've done. I've come out of this probably as well as anybody could hope.
Have you found any more time to invest in activities or things that you normally crave to do when you can't because you're at work?
I've found plenty of time to invest in activities that my wife's told me to invest in, i.e. sort of home improvements and the like. So, yeah, the house is probably looking as good as it ever will do. Once we're back, lockdown ends, it will start to deteriorate again. But, yeah, it's been mostly, what I've been doing exactly what I've been told to be doing.
Very good. Also, whilst this obviously is not a video, what people won't appreciate is that I'm looking at a clean-shaven man or relatively clean-shaven man. Now, at the start of the pandemic, you did make a decision that shaving every day wasn't necessarily going to be for you.
Yeah, but then I invested in a beard trimmer because to cut my hair and then having shorter hair on top than you've got down below just looked odd. So I just, it was scaring the kids. And also I'm doing a lot of Zoom calls at work. And it was more a point of contention than actually the content of the call. So yeah. I had to normalize myself a bit.
Did you like the beard though? Was there ever a moment where you kind of just thought this could be me?
Well, for about 2 weeks before then, all of a sudden. The one thing, weird thing about a beard, John, I don't know if you've ever grown one.
I get patches.
It's when you look down past your nose and you can actually see hair coming out your mouth or from the mouth region. Yeah, it's pretty gross. Yeah, that's definitely not a future thing.
You wouldn't recommend it, no. Okay, so as you say, the children have been home during lockdown. I know that I've got two children who are younger than yours, and we've tried to do some homeschooling with Arthur, who's currently three. How have you found homeschooling? Has it been difficult? Has it been enjoyable?
Well, if I was honest with you, John, I thought this was going to be a doddle, the homeschooling, because I qualified as a teacher many years ago, so I qualified as a chemistry and biology teacher. And then when I was doing a bit of homeschooling, I found that the only talent I have is to reduce my kids to tears in 2 minutes. So since then, my wife has actually genuinely been, who is a genuine teacher and knows what she's doing, she's been taking on the homeschooling tasks. I just run about outside with the boys playing football.
I know from previous conversations that you are a very athletically fit person. You know, you are someone who enjoys exercise, and one of those focuses is the triathlon. Is that something that how does one get started in triathlon?
You take the plunge, you enter one, is about the only way you can do it. I mean, the way I came to start doing triathlon is a bit sort of convoluted. I used to play rugby a lot, and then I broke my leg, and then I broke my jaw in three places, and now got four metal plates in there. So I decided non-contact sport was probably not the way forward. Wow. I've got a friend who went to watch him do a triathlon in Salford and thought, why not? I'll enter the one in 12 months' time. And then it's very addictive. The good thing about it is it's really, really varied. So if you get bored with the running, you do a bit more cycling. You get bored with the cycling, you do a bit more swimming. And it's midlife crisis stuff. I mean, if you like wearing lycra and things, then it's right up most people's street. But it's it's just take the plunge. If you just don't even think too long and hard about it, I can't do it, just enter one and then train for it. And then you'll find you can do it.
The other endurance thing that... that has been going with me recently is the endurance of my playing, and I have to say that we've tried very hard at Foden's to make sure we are engaging with our audiences and our followers. We put out videos regularly, and I don't know about you, but we can have this honest conversation because obviously no one's listening. Well, not right now, but. I know that when I get that email from Richard Spielberg Poole, and he's amazing with his videos, it's incredible. But I know when I get that, there is a moment where I go, oh, I'm going to have to get it out again. I'm going to have to get it out. And I have to build up like 2 or 3 days worth of just getting things working again. How have you been keeping your chops in shape?
John, I'm sure you understand that as Principal Third Cornet in the band, I take my level of playing ability and the very seriously. So the cornet, I mean, I spend before every recording, like diktat that comes out from Richard, I spend about half an hour just getting my valves moving again, and it's more like a hitting instrument with a hammer, getting it working and then getting out and seeing what comes out at the end. So I've also got the fortunate benefit of I have a deputy who also playing the same part, so like there's a fair chance that two recordings come into Richard that he could probably cobble together like most hours that are required.
I'm sure it's an absolute pleasure for him to sit and listen to the contributions, the significant contributions that yourself and Andy Roth make. I'm sure they are a delight for everybody. Now, obviously, it's not always been that way. You know, when lockdown isn't happening, you know, somebody who's a regular member of the band, you know, you've obviously over the last 30 years, 35 years, you've taken your playing not just seriously, but obviously to the very top level. And before you joined us, something that I know we personally don't hear very often from you is that you were a member of the Scottish co-op band, and you were there for some time. So just talk to that. How did the invitation arrive to join the co, and how long you were there, and what was it like, you know?
Well, as you know, John, I don't like talking about the time that I played with the co very much, so it's rarely mentioned within banding circles. But yeah, it was just good luck. When I was really young when I joined the co, we were talking about 1985 or something, I was about 14. It's just my teacher, or one of my teachers at the time, was the principal euphonium, John Stark, of the co, and he said, "Do you want to come along for a play?" And so I came along, and it was the old days where you had to do a stand-up audition and stuff like that. Play something like Zelda in front of half the band, and it was just like, it was appalling. But they must have taken pity on me, so they let me in, and then that was it. And I was the only player under legal drinking age in the band, so I spent like the next 4 or 5 years being snuck into the back of pubs and stuff and hidden away, and fed the occasional half pint of whatever that pub happened to be doing that was cheaper on offer at the moment at that time. So I loved it, but flipping hell, it was a baptism of fire in terms of growing up quickly. But the time when I joined was just the best time to join the club, because it was Howard Snell was taking them, just started taking them, and then the trajectory that they had in terms of improvement was just about rocketed. And then probably the pinnacle, although Howard Snell didn't take them, was winning the Nationals in 1990. But there was another Foden's connection in terms of they were conducted by John Hudson, who was the cornet in the band.
When did you hook up with us?
It was, I think it was 2013 or 2014. I can't remember the year exactly, but I do remember it was just prior to Whit Friday when we won everything. So it was the time we had the clean sweep. And I thought, this is absolute doddle playing for Bones. Like, it's just, we're going to win everything and sweep the Bones. But it was great. It was just on the back of a phone call from Wilkie. I don't know where he got my contact details around. I don't know whether it was recommended or anything like that. So it just said, "Do you want to come along and play?" He did ask me to debt prior to that, but I think it was somewhere down in Cornwall or something. So I said, like, no, I would love to, but I might just, there's a reason you're asking me to debt and you can't get players for this one, I think.
Do you know what? It's amazing you talk about, you know, you joined just before Foden's won all of the prizes at Whit Friday. There's a couple of players who joined in the summer of 2012, and their first experience of contesting was with Foden's was the double in 2012. What a way to start! So they won the double, and I think they just must have thought, "This is it! I have made it." And then we didn't win anything for the next 3 years.
Yeah, just when I joined.
other than Whit Friday, interestingly. But I think the come down off of that rush from the end of 2012 must have been significant. So you've been with the band for 6-7 years. You know, obviously you can't compare bands with bands, but you know, you've not left the band. So I'm assuming there's something about it that keeps you coming back.
The great thing about Foden's, I've got to say, is that it's a really stable band, and there's a great camaraderie about that. Everybody is friends, genuinely, in the band. Probably I've been in the band maybe 5-6 years, and there's probably still 14 or 15 players still in there from the time I joined. I don't think there's many top bands that you could actually say have a sort of similar record. And also, the variety of the sort of stuff we're doing in terms of, I mean, there's highlights in there that I could never have dreamt of doing, just as I say, lowly third cornet player, but playing with like a rock band like British Sea Power, or doing a Mike Lovett CD, like total different genres of music. It's absolutely fantastic.
And last thing, they're completely unrelated, but you know, in this time of kind of lockdown and you know, the challenges we're facing all across the world, if you were you know, transposed into being a superhero and you could have one power, what would it be?
It's an easy one. Jedi mind trick. Remember when Obi-Wan Kenobi says, "These are not the droids you're looking for."
Yeah.
That would be the one, because hopefully, I mean, I came to Foden's to hopefully win an Open at some stage, and maybe a European if we're really fortunate. So if I could exert that influence in the box, I think, yeah, win by any means.
Perfect. Robin, lovely to chat to you. Thanks ever so much.
Pleasure.
Speak
Cheers.
To
Thanks,
you.
Bye.
Bye. Well, that brings our first ever Foden's Lockdown podcast to a close. A huge thanks to our guests today, Nigel Birch, Irene Garner, Nadia James, and of course, Robin Basu. Thanks to our technical team of one, Ian McKnight, for knitting this all together so seamlessly. And lastly, to you for joining us and listening to the show. We'll be back next month to meet more members of the extended Foden's family. But until that time, please stay safe and keep on buzzing.